All right, man. Welcome to the Big Tone Show. First episode, episode number one. Had to kick this thing off with a bang, man. First thing I want to say is I've been planning to do this podcast show for a while, man, and it's a great honor to kick it off on our first episode with my homeboy, straight from Sacramento, California, Desus Nettles.
Yeah,
what's up,
yeah,
my bro?
Yeah, Tone, what's up, man? Thanks for having me.
Appreciate you sliding through,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, it's a pleasure, homie.
All right, man. So,
what's going on?
How you doing with that quarantine thing, man?
I'm doing all right, man. I'm just in the house, just chilling, man. Getting high.
Getting high. Know. What you smoking on out there, man?
I'm smoking on whatever, man. Cookie, Kush, whatever.
I got you, bro. I got you, man. Shit's crazy, man. Something that we never had experienced, man. How your kids doing with it, bro?
Oh, they like it, man. It's like a big vacation to them.
Shit. Imagine that when we was young, man. If we got a chance to stay home from school, not have to deal with none of that shit. That's like a dream come true for a little kid, man. But I don't think they understand. My kids don't understand the severity of it. They're just used to chilling at the house anyways. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's just crazy.
But anyways, man, so what you up to, bro? What's new with D right now?
Nothing much, man. Just working on this album right now. You know, I'm in slow motion. You know what I mean? It's better than no motion. I'm working on album number three, my third solo. Calling it The Realest.
Okay, The Realest.
A few tracks deep right now. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully I'll have it out by the summertime.
Yeah, and you got two projects out already. For those that don't know, say from a fan's perspective, you know your first album was called Son of a Gangster.
Yeah, I dropped that like in 2013. That was 2013.
What made you want to title that Son of a Gangster?
Oh, just cause, man, just the way, you know what I mean, like the way Pops raised us, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. It ain't really cool, but you know what I mean, it is what it is, you know what I'm saying?
That's
what
it was, shit,
but you know what I'm saying? It's my opinion of Pops. I always saw my Pops, man, he's straight up gangster, man.
Pops is an OG, huh?
Hell yeah.
So how was that like growing up in Sacramento, man, being around that type of shit, you know, being a young kid, say go back to elementary school type of shit, man, just seeing that type of stuff out there in Sac. How was that, man, being a young Desus Nettles, man?
Man, it's crazy, you know what I mean? I didn't really start getting to all that shit to like the age of like 13, 14 years old, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, man, it's been, it could get crazy though, man. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Been through some shit, but blessed to still be here, you know what I'm saying? Free and alive.
Definitely, man. And so going back, you said you got around that stuff around 13, 14 years old, man. Now before that, say when you were young, what elementary school you go out there in Sac?
In Sac, I went to John Reith Elementary. That's right there in South Sacramento in Valley High. You know, what was there?
So like middle school. Like I hear middle school to me, it was like when most people started getting involved with that shit. You know what I mean? Elementary, it was kind of people knew what's up, but you were still kind of a kid, a little innocent.
Yeah.
Middle school was like when more people started getting involved with that type of shit. And then high school, of course, when motherfuckers was really, really active, getting crazy on that shit, man. Was it the same for you out there in Sacramento, bro?
Yeah, it's exactly the same, man. Just like anywhere else, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So like, when you were in elementary, though, like, what kind of kid was you, man? Was you actually a good kid and just got, you know, just started running with the homies? Or were you just kind of like a little badass from the gate with the silver teeth type of kids, you know what I'm saying?
Hell no. Like, me and my brothers, we always like to play sports, you know what I'm saying?
Hell yeah.
We grew up, you know what I mean? We have a rough upbringing, you know what I'm saying? We're all very close, you know what I'm saying? But, yeah, we just like to play sports, like I said, you know what I mean? Hitting middle school and, you know what I mean, want to show how tough you are and shit, you know what I mean? And
yeah.
I just...
No, same with me, man. I was really involved with sports and shit, man, and that was my passion, you know, playing baseball and stuff. I was a skinny-ass kid, so, like, I wanted to play football, but I would have got ran the fuck down. I was tall and skinny as fuck, man, but I was a good-ass baseball player, man. I was a pitcher and first baseman, and like you said, the same shit. Getting caught up, you know, when you walk outside, you know, you're in the neighborhood, and, you know, you rock with what's going around you, you know what I mean? So, obviously, like, I got influenced on other type of shit beyond the sports, so went that kind of way, man. Then in high school, bro, did you finish high school or you drop out, man?
No, I graduated high school, believe it or not.
That's what's up, shit, me too,
I did,
man.
Though. I graduated, though.
Yeah, okay.
Ain't nothing wrong with that.
Hell no, shit, that's what's up, man. I'm proud of that accomplishment,
yeah, I got
man.
Two diplomas, though, man. Straight up.
The street diploma winner.
Hell yeah.
You know what's crazy, man? It is like I was fucking up and you know, mom's caught me doing some fucked up shit. She caught me slanging out the house, so she gave me the boot, right? And I was living on my own with a couple of my homegirls, right? I had like they had a Section 8 little spot, so I had in my own room and all that. But I would kick it all night. I would be just partying with the homies, doing my thing, but I would still get up and go to school. It was continuation school. All you had to do was show up, you know what I mean? But I still got up. I remember getting up and homies were like, man, what the fuck you doing? Like, man, I'm going to school. I don't want to end up like yo ass, bro. You know what I mean? But that's something that was always in me. Just even though I was still in the streets grinding, I always had a little bit of ambition and goals. So I knew like that was something I wanted to do was finish school. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I made sure I finished school because, you know, I got my girlfriend pregnant. Like I was like in like a junior in high school.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
And yeah.
By the time I was a senior, I was already 18 years old. You know what I'm saying? I had the choice whether to drop out or, you know what I'm saying? try to get my diploma, you know what I'm saying? And I did it for moms, I did it for my, you know what I mean, my unborn son and shit like that, because I probably would have, you know what I mean, stopped going if it wasn't for those reasons.
See, motherfuckers think because you in the streets that you don't got a head on your shoulders. Like, it's like you got to be one or the other. And I was like, man, I'm going to prove that shit wrong. Like, I'm going to get money, I'm going to do this, but I'm going to be responsible with certain things too, you know what I'm saying? Hell so yeah, it's always, now I respect that, man, I respect that, man. And then, so you had your first son when you were, you said how old again?
I was 17 when I had him. 17? Yeah, I was a baby myself.
Little babies having babies, huh? Yeah. And you got how many right now, bro?
I'm number four.
Okay.
I'm done now.
Shit, you gonna get them gray hairs off that shit, man.
I already got them.
You finna get snip
do
snip?
Mind? Do you mind?
All right, go ahead, bro, help yourself. Right. You finna get snip snipped after that?
Nah, hell no. Taking my bullets.
You just had, so you had a new, you had an, your the newest one is your son.
The Santana, he was born last year. He's born, he's one right now.
He's one?
Oh, yeah.
How's that having a 1 year old, bro?
It's cool, it's doing it all over again. Man. He's doing it. Last time we had a baby was like 10 years ago, so this is, yeah, I mean, it's doing it all over again. I don't mind it though, I enjoy it.
Nah, blessing, bro, because yeah, my son, he's two. Terrible twos.
Yeah, he's two already?
He's two, bro. Yeah,
he's probably tearing shit up, for sure.
He's always beyond tearing shit up, bro. It's see, another thing with this quarantine thing, you know, it's giving us no option but to be at home with your kids, right?
Yep.
Excuse me. So it gave me a different respect for these daycare people because my son is crazy as fuck. They're just needy. They want attention. Oh, my son is at least wants attention at all times. Like, my oldest is 13, so she can go chill in her room and do her own thing and shit. Having a son running around is crazy as fuck. But that's what's up, man. So your last name's, your rap name's Desus Nettles, so you went with your real full name. Obviously, you know your last name, you're repping. I see your guy's name. I see your guy's name holds weight out there in Sacramento. Definitely deep as fuck, man. How many of you guys in your immediate family?
There's a lot. Like, me, like, my mom and dad had seven of us. There's four boys and three girls, but like, my pops come from like a family of nine, and they all had kids, and like mostly all boys too. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. So your family reunions look like a damn fucking junta.
Oh, hell yeah, my family reunions are deep, man. They're hella deep.
Yeah, so like they say you guys, they pretty much put that out there. Like, your last name is like your own gang. You got, you like, this is all family, brothers and cousins. Yeah. But you guys look like
it's crazy.
They make you portray that look.
It's crazy how they made it look. You know what I'm saying? Because, you know what I mean, they just they exaggerated a little bit. Made it seem like we were a crime family. There ain't nothing like that. We stuck to ourselves, you know what I mean? And
if it's any other race, you'd be a club. And if it's looking like us, it's a fucking gang. You know what I'm saying? So I feel understand it that, man. So anybody that listens to music, you know, you're getting a lot of fans. You're growing as an artist. You know, I could see this stuff, man. You know, I analyze and see the game. And you got a lot of people that fuck with you, man. And one of the reasons I fuck with you and I think you're dope is because you tell your story through the music. You know, some people, I've worked with a lot of artists, and some people, they're just rapping. There's no substance behind it. There's no meaning behind it. And they might rhyme tight. They might have good delivery, but there's nothing there to make me, I won't say respect that person, but there's nothing there that makes me intrigued with that person. Like, when you rap, you tell a story. You could tell you've been through some real shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, going back to your first album, you said Son of a Gangster. I remember certain things you're talking about. Like, you said you seen your pops get shot in front of you and stuff like that, man. How go back to that time. How old are you when that happened, bro?
I was like 14.
Yeah.
I was like 14 when that happened.
So you was kind of already gamed up on the game a little bit and stuff
like
that.
Yeah, I was. It was just it was a scary night, though, man. I was a kid, you know, and Pops has always been you know what I mean, a tough dude, you know what I'm saying? Never gave a fuck or nothing like that. And we had a little encounter with some dudes, you know what I'm saying? And there was a lot of them, and it was just me, my pops, and my brother. My pops took us over there, you know what I'm saying, to handle business. And it's crazy, because I was just talking about this the other day, how, like, we was just kids, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And my pops was over there bringing us to shit like that, you know what I mean? Yeah. And we was going to get busy or whatever, but those other dudes, they wasn't trying to fight, and they just pulled out a gun. And,
oh, shit.
You know what I'm saying? My pops rushed him, and he popped my dad in his head, like his collarbone, his elbow.
Oh, shit, he got hit like that?
Yeah.
Was he laid out, or was he kind of like?
Nah, he was out. I thought he was dead, bro. It was crazy. Shit. He was in my arms bleeding. Oh, damn. You know what I'm saying? Shit was crazy. And then my brother, he was with me, too, and he ended up getting shot in his leg, bro. So, it was just scary.
The same day? Yeah, the same thing.
So, fuck. They got some aluminum, but, you know, pops pulled through. You know what I'm saying? He got nine lives like a motherfucker.
Straight
but.
Up.
He's good, though.
So that helped you grow up real fast, son. That is, that puts you up on your toes.
For
real
sure.
Quick.
You know what I mean? That kind of like changed a lot of shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Changed a lot of shit for me.
Yeah. No, so after that, man, like going back to that, so how did that, like, did that, to a normal kid, 14 year old kid would be spooked, like, man, I want to get away from this shit. You know, obviously, you know, things. pan out a certain way. Did that shit make you more angry? Did that shit give you more like, man, fuck these dudes, like I'm trying to go in now? Or that yeah, shit kind of like, it was just I got like, a second second think this
nah,
shit.
It was just like that, you know what I'm saying? Because I was real young, you know what I'm saying? And it was scary, you know what I'm saying? It was one of the scary nights of my life. I thought I lost my father, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, man, it kind of like, since like then, like it was more like not really not giving a fuck. It was just more like, fuck them, yeah. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, time to go to war type of shit.
Yeah, but I was, like I said, I was real young, you know what I'm saying? So motherfucker couldn't do much, you know what I'm saying, that age, you know what I'm saying? But
man, that's crazy, bro. Yeah, most motherfuckers wouldn't know how to handle that shit, man. You know, I've seen people shot and stuff like that, but I've never seen no one like my pops or my immediate family like that. I've had close friends, seen them hit with slugs and laid out and stuff, so I could kind of relate to the feeling, but I know it's a whole different beast when it's your fucking, when it's your father, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, shit was crazy.
Yeah, I mean,
shout out to my pops though, man.
Yeah, shout out to OG, man. You know what I'm saying?
He took three for his sons.
You know, he builds who you are. You know, you become the type of man you are from all this type of stuff. You know what I'm saying? And yeah, so I see they portray that shit with you guys out there. So I know, like out here, we have our history in Antioch. A lot of people know our history with stuff like that, and it made us hot with the cops and it put a big spotlight on us. And I seen, you know, you post on your gram the other day the same thing. They had a whole news clipping about you guys out there, man.
Yeah.
So obviously you're kicking up some dust for the media to get wind of it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So what happened with that, man? What was that story about, bro? Well,
there was just a lot of shit going on in the part of Sacramento where I'm from in the north, you know what I'm saying? And like we got a big family. We know a lot of people and just, you know what I mean, the police, it just kind of like a lot of shit going on kind of like pointed to us and it had really nothing to do with us, you know what I'm saying? So they're misinformed.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, they got, you know what I mean, they recovered some illegal things, you know what I'm saying? But they weren't really trying to link us to other shit, you know what I'm saying, that we had nothing to deal with.
It seems sometimes they try to find an excuse if they want you, because they did that with me too as well, where they want to find a reason to get you. They're going to find some kind of blanket excuse to get you, knowing, all right, we might recover some weapons here, this and that, you know what I mean? And the fucked up thing is, even like in these times, man, like you might have fucked up young. Like I fucked up. I caught a case when I was 18 years old and caught my a felony when I was 20, right? And you know, now as a 37-year-old man, you know, you know, me, I was able to get my shit situated, but a lot of people, you want to be able to protect your family. And, you know, we're going through a crisis like right now, and they make it where you can't even really, all right, so you get caught with a gun, and you're a criminal, you're going to jail. But if I was a different type of ethnic group or something like that, I'm a conservative Republican, and I'm gun-bearing guy, and I'm protecting my family. So there's always, it's kind of a fucked up situation, because we make bad decisions when you're young. Now you can't even really protect yourself, you know, because you're going to be looked upon as a fucking criminal and they want to throw you away for do some time for that shit.
Yeah.
It's like fucked up double standard with that shit, man.
Yeah, those motherfucking police still fucking me to this day, man. Like, they know me. Like, when they see me. When they see me and my brothers, cousins, bro, they just roll up on us. We ain't doing shit wrong. They probably don't want to see you do good, man.
You know, even if they see you doing good and hustling and working and doing, making music, whatever, raising your family, they probably don't want to see that. You know what I mean? That probably bugs them more than anything.
Yeah, it's crazy, though, because some of them, they see, you know what I mean? Some of them are cool. They mention my music a lot, too. Like, I've had a hella police tell me they like my music.
Yeah. I mean, you can't deny good music at the end of the day, you know? I said, because I listen, you know, I've been a part of your music and helped you record stuff, and I've seen you been doing it, and you don't glorify no bullshit in your music. You know, you speak the real.
No, I try to glorify. I just talk about what I've been through and like what I learned from.
It seems like the people that glorify that shit ain't even really been through it to me. Like when I see someone like young just rapping about they got this, they got that, they trying so hard to me to show that they have something. So to a real motherfucker that been through some shit, you talk about it, but you're not glorifying it. It's just reality. It's like, I don't got to show you I'm this dude. Like, you should already kind of know, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's why I get that from your music, bro. When you speak, you're telling a story. You're letting the fans know. You're letting me know. You're letting people know your mentality. And you're not scared to show your vulnerability and show your weaknesses and your strengths. And that's what makes a real artist to me. You know what I'm saying?
It's realness, bro. You know what I'm saying? I ain't got nothing to hide. You know what I'm saying?
Straight up.
So I tell everybody, just be yourself. Do your thing. You know what I'm saying? Don't try to act like something you're not, because you ain't going to get far.
Nah, definitely, bro. You know, and especially like coming from the generation I was in doing music, like your car would get pulled quick in this shit. Now, you're going to have people that, hey, that's a different story. Y'all fuck him, fuck this. But the facts of the, you know what I'm saying? Like, you got to be a real motherfucker to rap for my generation.
Yeah, hell yeah.
You know, this 2020, you could wear dresses and fucking makeup and you could get away with that type of shit nowadays, you know? But that's what's up, man. You know, definitely, bro, you came a long way with it, man. What's your plans with it, bro? Do you have any kind of goals other than music? Or
You know, it's crazy because people ask me that all the time, and like, I just enjoy making music, and I don't really care about all the other shit that comes with it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I am trying to take advantage of this opportunity that I have, though. You know what I'm saying? But as far as, like, me trying to pursue a rap career, that's never really been, like, a dream of mine. Yeah. I just always enjoy just making music, and it just so happens that, you know what I mean, a lot of people feel it, you know what I'm saying, and can relate to it. So, you know what I mean, I just love doing it. That's why, you know what I mean, I try to do it as long as I can.
Yeah, nah, you know what, that's crazy, is I feel like I'm the same way. Like, people were like, how come you don't go do this and you don't do that? And I'm just, it's hard to explain to somebody that the passion of doing music and telling my story, and I like making music, I love doing that, but sometimes I don't like the shit the rap comes with.
Yeah.
You know, and some dudes want to do rap just for the fame. They want that shit that comes with it. They want to look like the dude on the camera. They want to look like they're getting money. They want to put themselves out there, so that's why they do music. With me personally, I like doing music to get the message out there, to express myself. And I think people see that through the music. That's why me and you were able to do a little bit better than most. You know, of course, you know, I don't think, you know, people, they think because we never made it to a big platform like Drake or Meek Mill that you didn't make it. Yeah. But you could be very successful independently, have an impact in your own area, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Without getting to that level. Of course, there's levels to anything and success in anything. But, you know, that's something I agree, bro. Like, you know, just having passion with it, man. And you know, excuse me. Now, what's the, say, like, so now you've been rapping, you dropped a couple of projects, and you started getting a little bit of more of a buzz, right? So you're starting to see more love, and you know, you drop an album, you drop a song, and more, I'm sure, social media likes and comments, and people in the street start acknowledging you more. When you started seeing that, how did that feel? Did that make you feel like more accomplished? Did you like that? Did you feed off it? Or were you kind of like, man, I don't like the attention?
It kind of tripped me out, you know what I'm saying? Because I remember, like, just like one day, like, I posted a video up or something, and that motherfucker had got like a quick little rap video, you know what I'm saying? And that motherfucker just started getting like a lot of motherfucking views. Like, and like, I woke up and it had like 30,000 views, like, damn near in one night.
I remember that.
Some shit like that. And it just tripped me out, you know what I'm saying? That many people is tuning into my shit.
That's and it just started. Just said, I'm rich, bitch. And I made it.
It's cool though. You know what I'm saying? Like I said, I just care about putting the music out, the fame and all that other shit. I don't really care about it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
It's cool. You know, people recognize you and shit. Cause I get that a lot more. You know what I'm saying? Like, damn, everywhere I go. You know what I'm saying? Different cities and shit. And it's cool and shit. But I mean, I don't like it all that much.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I be telling everybody, like, when I talk about this, people, like, I don't like really being seen before I can see them. You know what I'm saying?
Straight
like. I don't know who, you know what I'm saying, who doesn't like me and tries to come up and play that part.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
They know you, but you don't know them.
Exactly.
That's what we're talking about.
Exactly. It's cool, though, because, you know, but other than that, though, everybody be showing love. Ain't nobody tried no shit.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
No, I feel the same way with that, man. It's different because you come from a different part of the game. And when someone's looking at you, you're like, why the fuck is this dude looking at me? And he might. And sometimes I forget I do music. You know, like, I'm a normal dude. I'll be running through the town, going to the gym, just doing my normal shit, right?
Yeah.
And someone will look at me, and I'll be like, what the fuck is this dude looking at? You know what I'm saying? So the old me's thinking, like, I don't know if it's something I did in the past to somebody. You don't know what it is, you know what I'm saying? This dude likes me, hates me. So, definitely, bro, like, you know.
Just got to keep your guard up, you know what I'm saying?
So let's rewind a little bit, man. Let's go back to, we were talking about how you got caught up. And you were on the news. They put you guys all on blast on the news and shit like that.
Yeah.
When did you, were you already locked up when you seen that news clip come out?
I was in jail.
Okay. Did you see that in jail? Because I know.
I didn't see it in jail. My girl came to visit me like the next day. She told me it was on the news. I was like, you fucking serious? And on some real shit though, the way I felt about it though, like, I wasn't like all cool. It was on the news. Like, it was kind of fucking embarrassing.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. You know what I'm saying? So.
How old were you?
I think I was like 25. Okay. It happened in 2013.
So you kind of like were at that borderline, because see, if that happened, like, if I was 21, 22, I'd have been like, that's dope, fool. You see me on the news, you know, that would have been more of a glorifying thing.
I was already at that age. I was already trying to grow, you know what I'm saying? Because I done seen a lot of motherfuckers get popped and go to jail and all this shit. You know what I mean? It was getting close.
Yeah.
It was really getting close to home and shit.
Well,
so
you had stuff to lose too at the moment.
Hell,
you know, you had kids already and stuff that, so it was different.
Yeah, there was a time though where I've always cared at the fact I had kids and shit, but there was a time I cared less, you know what I'm saying, about. You know what I'm saying? Because whatever I do doesn't just affect me. You know what I mean? It affects my kids and my family a lot more. You know what I'm saying? So.
Nah, definitely. I think that way too. And I think, you know, like me, my situation, having a family, having kids, like, since I started rapping when I was my first project came out when I was 20 years old. What I was recording when I was 18, 19. So my mentality was of an 18, 19 year old kid, right? So I have people tell me like, man, why don't you go back and rap like you did on Merciless and this and that? But me as a 37 year old man, there's no way I could go back to the mentality as an 18, 19 year old kid. I was glorifying. I was the shit we was doing too. So I was pumping the shit we was doing at that age. And, you know, of course, you know, the people that listened to us back then, you know, they grew up and evolved with us. So I think we still have a lot of support because their mentality has grown as well.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But there's still people that want you to be, they want your opinion to come out of, they want their opinion to come out of your mouth. You know what I mean? We want you to rap about the way we think. So some people don't want to see you grow and they think, oh, you done got too wise or you done changed your mentality. So they kind of look at that as weakness for these youngsters. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's the thing, a problem. Cause I got little homies. In my generation, we looked up to older homies. Some of these youngsters, man, they got their own mentality and they don't understand the you have to grow as you get older. And you know, and they're going to find out one day, either way, they're going to end up here or they're going to end up there. You know, that's a decision they got to make, you know?
Yeah, so some got to learn the hard way. You know what I mean?
But and it's like still,
it is what it is.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, you still, like, people don't understand switching your mentality doesn't mean you switched up who you are. Like, you staying true to the game. I'm still in my environment. You're still in your environment. You know what I mean? And it's just growing mentally, growing financially, making smarter decisions that help people, you know? And that's why I think they don't see the bigger picture. You know, I can't help feed nobody if my plate's fucking half empty. I want to fill this plate up so I can help feed people. You know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure, most definitely.
Yeah. So other than that, man, like with everything that's happened to you, the streets, you know, getting caught up and getting on the news, going to the getting locked up, and you got sentenced. You went to the pen for that, right?
Yeah, they gave me 3 years to a half, bro. I was in and out that motherfucker.
Yeah. Where'd you go? Where'd you end up?
I was at Susanville, and then I paroled from a fire camp. I had got some time off, so.
Okay.
You know, I got the fuck up out of there. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Fuck all that. That shit for the birds, bro.
When you that first day, when they slammed that door though, you remember how you felt though? Like what was going
through your mind? Yeah, I told myself, you know what I mean? I didn't have a whole lot to do, you know, a whole lot of time to do, but at the same time though, from being with your kids every day, you know what I'm saying, waking up to them every day, just gonna be gone for like, you know what I mean, like over a year, you know what I'm saying? I was ready for it. You know what I mean? I wasn't stressing, none of that. I just was just waiting just to get it all behind me.
It's harder when you're not knowing how much time you're going to get. That's probably the more stressful part.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
When you're fighting that motherfucker, whatever, man.
Yeah, I went in there, man, and I just told myself, you know, get my mind right, get my body right.
You did come out a little more in shape, boy. Them shirtless selfies was kind of popping at the moment, man.
Yeah, I was a big motherfucker, man. Like, and I'm short too, so I look back on pictures from those times. I was like, damn, how I do that to myself?
Throw them back on the Throwback Thursdays. Don't forget.
I've always been quick on my feet, though, man.
I was on that fitness hype too, bro. When you feeling good and you look good, you proud of it, man. You want to, you know, come out flexing, man.
I told myself too. Like when I was in there, I was like, man, might as well just get my body right. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
And that's all I did, man. I just tried to, like I said, get my mind right, get my body right. When I came out though, like I lost so much weight. Like my little brother was telling me, I was like, dude, what the fuck? He was like, you hella small.
Little skinny mini, huh? Was you writing a lot in there? Did you write any raps or not?
Nah, I didn't write raps at all.
Just trying to get day to day, huh?
Yeah, like rapping and shit. Like,
Read or anything?
Yeah, I read a lot of books and shit like that. But like rapping though, it's crazy because I was recognized in there a couple times by some homies.
Yeah.
Wanted me to rap and shit like that, but I didn't really do all that shit too much, man.
What kind of books you read in there?
Just like stories and shit, bro. Like
into the fictional, non-fictional.
Nothing with too much, you know, knowledge kicking. Yeah, not too much of that.
The Art of War.
Not too much of that, man. But
yeah,
I always made sure I had my program, my routine. Helped the time go by real fast, man. I was in and out that motherfucker.
I feel it. So when you got out, man, were you really trying to focus more on the music, more on getting your situation together? What was your mentality getting out? I know you said it wasn't that long, but that's still a long time for anybody, man, to sit down for a year and get back. You know, for a lot of people that, you know, you got guys that do stretches, you know, 10 plus years, you know, but yeah, you ain't going to downplay. That's still a year gone from your kids and to do some thinking, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I got friends, you know what I mean, and people that have done numbers, you know what I'm saying? It just trips me out, like.
Yeah,
fuck that shit.
Homies doing all day, never coming home. Yeah,
time.
Yeah. So like I said,
free the homies though.
Free the homies. But like I said, you had some redemption. You knew you was getting out. You know what I mean? So that's kind of like a reset button. You know, let me hit the bricks again and hit the ground running. You know. So when you did get out though, did you start working on music or like I said, did you start?
Yeah, a little bit, not too much though, man. You know what I mean? Like I said, I was just trying to bounce back, get back on my feet and shit. Mm-hmm. But yeah, man, it was like one of the happiest days of my life to get up out that motherfucker.
I
ain't going back. I've been out. I got out like in June of 2015. Been out ever since.
It's been a minute, huh?
Yeah.
And then right back to the grind, man.
Hell yeah.
So let me ask you, bro. So with all this being built and you are who you are now, you know, you're coming up in the music game, you know, you're getting more known around the streets and stuff like that. What's the pros, like the blessings of being you, and what's the cons, like the curses of being somebody in your situation?
I mean, like, a lot of people think it'd be cool, you know what I mean, just be like, I'm really known out here in Sacramento and shit, like, would think it'd be cool and shit like that, but like, lots of times it's not, you know what I'm saying? Like I said before, I don't really care about it. But it's not like me though. It ain't my fault that my last name rings bells. Like I said, I got a big ass family, and they all move the way they move, you know what I'm saying? And I just be rapping and shit about the life that we live, you know what I'm saying? But
like, you know, I said, you know, you're stuck in I won't say stuck. We're stuck in a certain box, bubble, you know, in our environments, right? So you have a lot of good. It doesn't mean there's a lot of negative. You know, there's a lot of good that goes along with that. Like I said, so what's something that this I won't say fame, just buzz, this stigma of being a rapper. What is something good that's come from that though? Like, what kind of benefits or what have you seen that the good part of the game? You know, it brings a lot of negative. But what has so far that you could think of that's some positive out of it?
I don't know. You know what I'm saying? Just like the shit I talk about. Hopefully, you know what I'm saying, someone could just learn from. You know what I'm saying? I talk about my experiences and then maybe they could learn from that, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. But I've even had a few people tell me, you know, I'm somewhat of a inspiration to them. And like, I really don't, that's not my intention to be nobody's inspiration. But it feels good though, just knowing that just my music could it really touches somebody.
Yeah. I mean, you got to think though, like if someone's watching, say a video gets 100,000 views, they'd be like, that dude only got, that's 100,000 people that done seen your shit, that heard your voice. And I trip out on that sometimes, like, damn, this video got 1 million fucking views. That's crazy, you know? So that does come with a responsibility. Like I said, people, and me, I keep thinking like, well, I ain't made it here yet. I ain't at this level, so I ain't achieved it yet. But you can't downplay where we're at because we still got a voice. There's still people that tune in, people that listen to what we got to say. And you do have an influence. I have an influence. So there's kind of a responsibility with that. Because one thing with me, like going back to when I said when I was doing my first album, I was 18, 19 years old. I didn't realize the message I was putting out. I was just rapping about my life and just glorifying the shit I was doing. You know, that's shit motherfuckers was really doing. But I had someone tell me, and I spoke this on another interview, but for anybody in here, I had somebody tell me that, Tone, I went to prison because of you. I'm like, what the fuck you mean? Bro, I was jamming your shit every day. You had me pumped. I was out here riding. And that shit didn't sit right with me, though. Like, I wasn't like, damn, like, for real, like, I didn't like hearing that shit, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I never really noticed until now. I get a little older and I'm doing a little better in life and I put out more positive type of shit, and I have little homies tell me, like, you know what, bro, I'm getting my shit, you inspire me, man, I'm doing this because of you, and I'm starting to do this because of you. I like, that shit makes me feel better as a person, bro, you know what I mean, beyond anything else, as a person, that shit makes me feel better.
It's a good feeling.
Yeah, because that's that, not just karma, but that's just good energy you're putting out. You know, and coming from, you know, a certain bad environment that we, because I grew up around, you know, seeing violence and seeing fucked up shit. You know, we had friends sent to prison forever and friends dying, you know, and having this little environment around us and coming, kind of like changing your mentality to go to a certain place, you know, and it rubs off on people is a good feeling, you know?
Yeah, it is.
Like, you know, like you said, you know, you got a product of your environment, man. I feel like, you know, it's like, I'm a product of my choices, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, straight up.
And I'm gonna live by the decisions I make is where I'm gonna be. I mean, anything can happen. We do get monkey wrenches thrown into our plans, you know, there's always kinks and things that happen, and we can't prevent that, but it's on how we react to things, you know?
As long as you bounce back.
Man, it's always a bounce back, man. You know, real hustlers bounce back, man.
Oh, yeah.
So anything you want to talk about, bro? You know, I know we just kind of making it feel like an interview and shit right now, man. And
what you
trying
been,
to
what
get
you
the
been?
Butterflies out the first episode, man. This is episode number one,
what
bro.
What you been doing?
Man, really, I've been quarantined, bro, going crazy thinking about what the fuck to do. That's why we starting the fucking podcast, bro. I just been chilling, man. You know, daycare, can't watch the kids right now, man. So I've been spending a lot of time with my kids. You know, just contemplating on, you know, the next move. Trying to stay healthy and do that, but I done went and did that little I won't say panic shopping, but when I went to the store and seen the shelves empty, I started snatching shit. Yeah. Like, all right, this ramen, you know, ramen was gone, but this looked good, and Cheez-Its and Doritos and shit. So I'm guilty, man. You know, when you have that in the house, it's hard. not to eat that shit, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
And I usually don't eat that type of stuff, bro. But yeah, just kind of been just kind of trying to ride this thing out, man. You know.
That's right. I've been asked a lot. People been asked about that mob influence too, man.
See
what's up with that.
Nah, we talked and we did post, man, and that's something we definitely have to work on. And you know, I haven't been in the studio since I finished my last album, so now we're getting back up in here. I'm definitely down to work on that, man, because that mob influence one, bro. We came with that one, bro.
Yeah, that shit slap. That shit slap. I was just listening to that shit the other day.
Yeah, like. I think we complement each other's style because there's certain rappers I rap with that I think they're dope. Same with producers. I'll be like, oh, that beat's dope, but I can't hear myself on it. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Or I can't hear myself with this person. It just doesn't mesh right. I think me and you go together good on music, man, and that's why, you know, I think we had a successful album. You know what I mean? I think that album was kind of slept on too, man, because that motherfucker go hard, bro.
That shit slap.
We probably should have did some videos or something to that shit, huh?
That's crazy, though, because I was on a... What year did you drop the Business?
The Business? No, it's crazy. You're talking about that. Fuck. What year was that Business at?
Like 05, maybe? No.
06?
06 or something like that.
That's crazy when you told me. You're like,
motherfucker, I was on that shit. You go, so you wait, was?
What song?
I'm like, yeah, motherfucker.
You know why? Because we didn't actually work in the studio together. You, I think Mad Dog and Bo Biz, or who was it?
Yeah, Mad Dog and Bo Biz. Shout out to Bo, though.
And Hugh Hef.
Jacket for Life, yeah.
Yeah, they sent me that song.
Yeah.
And you was on there. And I remember, I do remember, they're like, hey, we got this homie D. And I was, back then, I was picky on who I was fucking with.
Yeah.
And then I remember hearing him, oh, yeah, he went hard for sure. Because he was a song. You know what I mean? But like I said, I think that's why I forgot, because we didn't actually work on a song.
It trips me out because that was a long motherfucking time ago, bro. That's just been a minute.
So what's that, 10, 15, what's that, 14 years ago?
Yeah.
Doing the math. Come on, we high school graduates and I can't even do the math, man.
That's just crazy. Like, what, 06? Yeah. 14, about 14.
So I dropped my first album when I was 20, and I'm 30. I'm about to be 37 on Saturday, bro. So it's crazy. That's, fuck, bro. 17,
your birthday coming up, bro.
Yeah, man. 37, boy.
That's
right. You know, plucking out these gray hairs, man.
You going to Chippendales again? Or?
Man, nah, ever since you quit that motherfucker, ain't no point going, man.
Shit,
throwing quarters at your ass, boy.
How young you turning?
37, bro.
37, that's right.
Man, you
I'm trying to get there, too.
Man, how old are you, bro?
Shit, 20 plus 30. What was that?
20 plus 10, 18? Plus 12, yeah, plus yeah. 5.
And yeah. I turned 33 in December.
Okay.
And it's still ticking.
Nah, that's cool. Still, man, we still young, bro.
Grown ass man. Hell no.
I look at it like this, man. Like, I'm still, everyone's like, damn, you OG, you old. But I still got plenty of time to achieve my goals. So, like, even if I don't, you know, like, obviously, you know, people are like, oh, congratulations on your success. You made it here. But I'm still feeling like I ain't made it to that level yet, right? So, even if I grind hard for another 10 years and I achieve all my goals in 10 more years from now, I'm still gonna only be 47, man. If I could be 47 or 50 and retire,
you're straight.
I'm good, you know what I mean? Like, I've worked in the union for 15 years, man. I worked the 9-to-5 jobs, I've done that. And nothing against it, you know, if you know, you're happy with what you do, more power to you. But me, I wasn't happy in my situation. I was gone all day. I was missing out on raising my daughter, you know what I mean? And I had to make a decision. I was doing rapping, I was still chilling in the streets, and I was going to work. I'd have my job, I'd hustle on the side, I was doing music on the side, and I was like, man, I'm not good with this, bro. So, you know, I had to really make a real big decision and leave a union job. And being a felon and being our background, that's not hard to get. I mean, that's not easy to get, you know what I mean? So definitely had to make a choice and you know, pursue what I wanted to do. And so far, it's been a blessing, man. You know, I work for the freedom, financial freedom, and having time more than the money, you know. All the stuff we're doing right here, even trying to put out content to our listeners and stuff like that, is something for that I want to do, like a passion, more than just trying to make a dollar off people, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
But anyways, we're going to get drunk as fuck on this show. I don't even drink that hand no more.
I do.
Man, you know what, bro? I just don't have time no more, bro. Like, I try to balance everything I do. I just don't have time to sit and drink no more, you know?
Every once in a while, I got shit to do.
And when I feel like I'm doing that, I feel like I'm wasting time. Like, man, I could be doing this right now. What the fuck am I doing sitting right here drinking a motherfucking beer? But I do want to learn how to relax and have that time to do that, man. You know, sometimes you need to unwind and shit like that, man.
Hell yeah.
So besides, like, this music shit, bro, you got any other goals, though? Like, you have any other kind of plans with you, anything that, you know, that you have a vision to do? Or?
You know, it's great. I was talking to my girl the other day, too, and, like, I was just telling, like, you know, it'd be cool, like, if we were to open, like, a little business one of these days. Really not too sure exactly what, you know what I'm saying, but that's something, like, I plan on doing. It's still in the works, still brainstorming about it, but think about that shit all the time.
Nice, Yeah, man, something you can leave behind to your kids and shit like that.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Yeah. Speaking of your kids, man, your boy Angel, that boy gonna be the star. He probably gonna be the one to buy you a house, man.
Shit, man, for sure. I have one before then, but yeah, he got, bro, he writes all the time. Yeah. And it's crazy because, like, I don't push this shit on him at all.
Yeah.
Like, I don't try to say, hey, you know,
well, he's got
write,
it naturally,
write a rap. I've never told him that. Like, he be in his room, he ain't playing video games, he's listening to a beat.
Nice.
Writing into it all the time.
That's,
and like,
kinda like,
I don't help him. I've never helped him on one of his raps or nothing like that, bro. Just like, he's just been around it since he was a baby. Like, I'm talking about when I recorded Son of a Gangster, like, I was at home while she was at work and I had this home studio. Mm-hmm. So I was in there just in the studio all the time, and I have him, and he's like 1-2 years old, you know what I'm saying, while I'm doing it. And like, he would just sit there and just watch me and sit there and chill. And like, even as a baby, before he could talk, he would try to rap. He's always loved music.
That's crazy, bro. Cause that goes, like, just shows it's just naturally, you know, it's made for him. You know, you go back to guys like Steph Curry and Michael Jordan, these dudes, they already had something naturally. Some had to work harder than others, but he has that gift. Because I remember he recorded his song here, and I thought he was gonna be, I was like, damn, I never recorded no one that young. I do a little bro a favor, man, just get him in the booth and work on his dream. And he went in there one take, Jake the host.
He did.
He went through the hook and everything. He didn't even stop with the verse. He started doing the hook.
It's crazy because, like, when he puts his mind to something, like, he'll practice it till he gets it right.
He's only
9 years old. People always ask me, when's he dropping something? Like, he's not. You feel me?
9 years old.
I'm letting my son be a kid.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Which is cool. He likes to do that for fun, and we'll put something out in the future and shit. But as of now, you know what I'm saying? Letting him be a kid. My oldest son, too, I got a, like, my son to be 16.
And he gassing, too. I seen him. I got him on the gram. He's dope.
Yeah, he be spitting, too. He be spitting, too, though.
It's crazy because, like, your family has that fucking gene where you guys are just talented because your sister's dope. She got a dope ass
voice. Shout out to my sister Ginger, though.
Like,
yeah, she's
just
dope.
It's just crazy, man. Like, I don't have that. I take that back. I got my uncle that was like a mariachi singer. You know, he had little albums and shit like that. But, like, me, I'm not around that musical shit. You know what I mean? I picked it up. You guys have, like, some kind of genetic gene that just got it, bro.
Man, it's crazy because we all do that. Like, we don't really have music together like that, though.
Yeah. I mean,
like, you know what I'm saying? My sister, she does music. Everybody hits us up. We don't have a song together. She's just on a different time schedule. I'm on a different time schedule.
But it's understandable.
It'll happen, though. Yeah. It'll happen for sure.
Yeah, no, that's understandable. But like I said, it's just talent. Talent you can't teach. You know what I mean? It's like, you got certain things naturally. And I try to tell little homies that with the rap shit. Like, you know, some people want it hella bad. They just don't have it. And you could outwork most people. But if, like I said, it goes, like, if I wanted to be a fucking basketball player, I could work my ass off every day, but I'm not gonna go be on the Warriors, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, you gotta be kind of logical with certain things, and that's sometimes shit with the music, man. Like, people will hit me up, cool ass homies, like, dude, you're cool ass cat, and they wanna rap, and they just fucking ain't got it.
Yeah.
And then I wanna be an asshole, because, like, who am I to judge? But then,
you're not the asshole their friends are for not telling them that.
I'm just like,
they suck.
Keep working on it. Because I've had homies that came at me and they went and worked on it and they stepped it up. They did better, but then they wanted the fame that came with it. They wanted all the stuff that came. And then when none of that stuff came, they got like
discouraged.
Yeah, they thought they were going to blow up. They did one song and they thought they made it. And then they don't understand this shit is a longevity thing.
That's why, like, I notice a lot of people get discouraged when the people don't like their shit, share their shit. And like, that should be getting on my nerves, man. Because back in the days, though, when motherfuckers was rapping, when there was no social media, you know, motherfuckers didn't need none of that. You know what I'm saying?
You didn't have none of that.
You don't need none of that.
You go back when I started, bro, like, we had no social media at all, bro. We didn't even have the internet, I don't even think, bro.
Yeah.
Like, that was the internet. It wasn't as accessible as
it is today.
No, so, like, when I dropped my project, we had to go to, like, Promotional Express. I think they were in Hayward. We had to print, like, posters and flyers, and we had
footwork.
To go places. Yeah, so,
footwork.
Like, so we was going to hella sit. Like, I remember my very first album. When I dropped Merciless, I was juiced as fuck. Like, oh, I got something here. I was hungry.
Yeah.
So I remember my first trip was to San Jose. Back in the day, Santa Clara Street in San Jose used to be the strip.
Popper.
Every weekend was cruising, low, it was jumping. So I remember pulling up, and I would just pull up to, like, there was a McDonald's right there on Alum Rock, and I remember going up there and posting. People would pull up there, and there was a, I want to say Albertson's a little up the way. People would post that. Excuse me. And I remember pulling up there and just giving people my CD, right? I remember pulling up out there, and I first got out there, I seen some dude hitting switches. I pulled up on the side of him and I threw him my Merciless CD. They're like, what the fuck is he throwing at me? So I just threw him the CD. Going around handing the shit. Then I remember pulling up to that McDonald's on Alum Rock, and that same car pulled up slapping that shit. And he's slapping that, it's a Buster with Woody. That's a Buster with Woody. Because Woody had a name. So people were like, who the fuck is this dude with Jack and Woody and all these people on this album? And I just remember him slapping that shit like, this shit hard. And that right there felt like I made it. Like, I got something here. So I remember just going to the swap meets out there, to the car shows. I remember going to a fair out there in San Jose and walking up to some sadio-ass homies. They're all blasted back, looking like some straight gangsters, right? And I'm walking up just comfortable as fuck, and they giving me that. Who the fuck are you walking up? And hey, homie, no disrespect. Check it out. Mm-hmm. Bro, just slapped this shit and checked it out. And it was, you know, always a mutual respect type of thing. And just going out there hand to hand, pulling up to hood parties, man, just seeing people kicking it deep. Yeah. Because house parties were big back then, you know what I'm saying? So we see a house party cracking, we pull up and just go try to network. And I think that was a big part of me building my foundation. On top of it, you know, of course, everyone knows the story of Wood putting me in a situation to get hurt. And yeah, I had those legs to stand on for sure. But that gave me a push start. But I had to go do the legwork beyond that. I couldn't just say, hey, thanks for giving me that opportunity and then let me wait to see what it does.
I went, keep it going.
I went beyond that and pushed it further and did my own legwork. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, we were slapping that first album. I was in high school when that motherfucker came out. We was whooping a whole lot of ass.
Sacramento was always a good market, man. You know, we took over a lot of cities that were bumping it. And it was big. It was big, bro. Like, it was dope. I remember going to car shows and having lines of people, you know, waiting to take pictures and cop our new stuff, man. So, you know, and it's kind of cool because, you know, the shit we still drop is still, you know, the I would say our genre is kind of dissolved through the years. Like, it's not as popular as it was at one time. Yeah. I think homeboy rap and Northern California Chicano rap had its time, you know, and it's kind of dissolved and expanded to different things now. Like, it's more like, we don't care who you are, you better be tight. Yeah. Back then, if you're a homeboy rapping, like, oh shit, people were excited. Now, like, we don't give a fuck what you are. If you weak, if, you know, we want you to be tight, you know what I mean? So it had this moment, and it was tight being part of that history, you know? And still being involved and still dropping shit that's doing good. My last project was probably one of my best-selling albums to date.
How many you got right now? It's like 14, 15?
Something like that. I don't know. At Young Ace Book, how many albums I got out? Do you know, bro?
That's crazy.
Homeboy knows more sometimes better than I do.
Yeah.
Anything you want to talk about, bro? So, like, anything you want to bullshit about? Like, anything on your mind, man? Anything you want to get out to the public?
Just stay tuned, man. I'm working on this album, The Realest, you know what I'm saying? And I'm hoping to have it drop by the summertime.
Who you want to work with on there, man? Do you have any people you want to work with on
there? You know, it's crazy. There's a long list, man. I can't just name them off the top of my head. There's too many. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But I'm going
to... That's a good answer, because when the people ask me that, is it fucked up to hear to say, like, I don't really care about working with too many people?
Nah, not at all. Not at all. Like, me, like, I've never really had a desire or the urge to get at anybody or get a feature with somebody. You know what I'm saying? Like, I've never really reached out to anybody and asked for a feature. I could be a fan of their music and still won't really care if I get them on my song or not, unless I really want them to, you know what I'm saying? Not saying motherfuckers ain't talented, because there's a lot of dope people out there.
Yeah.
But I just work at my own pace on my music, and I don't know, like, to me, like, music is just, like, real, real personal.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? There's not a lot of motherfuckers that can relate to rappers that can relate to what I went through. So if they're hopping on with me, you know what I'm saying, most likely, and nine times out of the 10 of the times that, you know what I'm saying, they're gonna gas that shit.
No, I feel that, man. You know what's crazy is I have certain songs that are personal to me, and I'm like, man, I did this song, and I think it's like, who I want to get a feature on it. But I start thinking, like, who the fuck could, and I know there's better rappers than me, but who the fuck could, who would fit on this? Because I feel like if I reach out to somebody I want to work with, the majority of these rappers that got names, they're just, it's a hustle to them, you know, like, let me sell you a verse. Hey, this is what it is. Hey, I charge this, I charge that. And they don't care about the song. They get in their email, they just boom, 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 and they're about their bag. You know what I'm saying? And I ain't knocking the hustle, but for the most part, that's what people is. Me, I don't care about the name. I don't give a fuck if it's the biggest name in the world. If he's not passionate about making a song with me, then that's not a smart investment for me. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, like, I'd rather work with an upcoming artist that has no name, that's got hunger and is dope, that's got talent, and not somebody I'm just trying to help out. He's got to help out the song. You know what I'm saying? And work with them. And that's another thing I want to touch on, where a lot of people don't understand, being in my situation, and I could relate to your situation, is when you're trying to make good music, it's about making good music. It's not about personal shit. So I get people that get at me and be like, hey, how come you don't put this homie on? He's cool. How come you don't do this and you don't do that? And I'm just like, if I don't feel me and him can make good music together, I don't want to disappoint the song that's going to disappoint the fans that listen to my shit.
You want to put out quality. Yeah. That ain't nothing wrong with that.
So, like, if someone, when I drop an album, we're able to do pretty good because people pre-order the albums, right? They're anticipating something heat. So when you drop an album, we're expecting it to be fire, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to buy your shit because we know it's going to be gas, because I have faith in you that you're going to put out a good album. Now, if you're trying to do this dude a favor and this little homie a favor and your little cuz over here a favor, and he may not be the tightest dude, but you're going to try to help him out because you want to be a good dude, you're degrading the quality of your work trying to do favors to other rappers, and you're going to most likely disappoint your fans. So somebody that's been, you might have came tight on that song, but then the rest of the song's like, fuck, this dude kind of ruined it. Why'd you even get him on? You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense? Like,
it does.
And there's like a fine line of doing that. So me, I've always said, like, I'd rather piss off a rapper and hurt his feelings than disappoint the people actually going to buy my music and support my shit.
I feel it.
Because, like, why the fuck would you do a song like this just to make that dude happy and I disappointed all these people that support my shit? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So that's like my mentality. And it made me look like an asshole to people. I mean, I know that, and that's just something I got to deal with. You know what I'm saying?
It is what it is.
But at the same time, there's sometimes you don't want to piss off the wrong people. So I'll work with this homie. Yeah. You know what I'm going to keep this cool. I'll show the homie love.
I've done a lot of favors and shit before too. You know what I'm saying? A few songs I ain't too proud of.
But that's on my projects. When it comes to my projects, my integrity is more important than anything. I'll do verses and show homies love. I've done that. You know, most of the time, hey, if I fuck with you, bro, I'll do this love, this work. You know what I'm saying? But if to get on my album, I gotta holler at you. I gotta want you on my shit. You know what I'm saying?
I've had people hit me up all the time telling me, hey, bro, let me get on your next album. Let me get on your next album.
Yeah. I've had people try to pay me.
To get on top of your shit?
Can I pay for a placement on your next project? You know, I've had people try to pay me G's. It don't work that way, bro. I'm not going to do that because I feel like I'm going to disappoint the people that pre-order my shit. And I understand I'm not on that big level, but I do have a following where they're expecting quality. My thing is I'm not jeopardizing that for nobody, bro. Like, you could hate me, you could love me for it, but the people that buy my shit and buy my products will appreciate that.
Everybody gotta have a dream.
Well, hustle and flow ass. Yeah. That's your line right there. Everybody say, did you say motherfuckers tell you look like what's homeboy's name?
Terrence Howard.
Terrence Howard looking like motherfucker.
He look like me. I don't look like that motherfucker.
Running with that one. That's crazy. He wishes. Man. It's them fucking hazel fucking little green eyes over there.
I was born like this, man.
That's crazy, man. I remember seeing you posting a meme about that, man. That shit had me rolling though.
Well, which one?
You posted something, the lookalike. You said Cookie.
And it's funny too, because a lot of people say my girl looks like Cookie.
Yeah, that's what it was.
And she kind of does a little bit.
Yeah, that's crazy, man. I remember that shit. It's crazy because it's me and you had a little online beef going around, and people was really entertained every time we was going at each other's dick.
Yeah, until you waved the white flag, bro.
I said, man, let's call the troops, bro, because this shit going to keep going.
I was like, all right.
White flag, shit, fuck all that.
Fuck with shit.
Nah, man, but shit, bro.
You know what I don't like when me and you be going back and forth and motherfuckers want to add in their 2 cents and be saying some stupid ass shit.
You know what's funny, bro? People be inboxing me trying to give me ammunition. Be like, look, post this.
And I know, I got the same thing.
It's probably the same dude.
It is. Remember when he was boneheaded? He was big.
What about the one? Was that the one me holding the catch? You seen that one?
Yeah. You see that one or not? I did, yeah. I seen all those.
DM that shit to me too, man. But like I said, man, you know, we have fun and we could go back and forth. It's like that even in real life, man. You know, when you got a homie and me and you could go back and forth clowning each other, and this motherfucker comes in and thinks he could make fun of somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Like, hold up, bro. Me and you could talk to each other like that, but you can't talk to me like that, bro. So yeah, man. I think, you know, with social media, people are comfortable doing that type of shit, man.
Good. What's up with the Purple Malo? You still got that going on?
Yeah. So, you know, of course, because you know, I don't want to speak on. I'm supposed to be working with a new company to be announced. We'll see if everything unfolds right, and it's a big opportunity to get involved with the compliant market. Cannabis now is not like a taboo thing like it was back in the day when motherfuckers had grow spots and it was like you was in a trap house really paranoid and shit, you know. Now it's more of a mainstream thing. And I got my foot in the door with the compliant market. And hopefully this company I'm working with unfolds to be a successful thing, and we'll have the all the genetics, the Purple Merlot and everything else that we bring into the menu and all the dispensaries across California, man, from, you know. And that's the goal, you know what I mean? Trying to expand everything, man, you know, and take everything that we're doing right now, make it expand bigger, you know, yeah, we want to grow, sure. You know, if I'm in the same spot I was 5 years ago, I feel like I've never evolved, you know, I'm trying to always grow and step up and help the people and give the outlet to help people and inspire people and help people grow, yeah. You know, and if no one's going to do it, we're going to do it, you know what I'm saying?
Straight up.
And that's kind of like my vision with all this, bro, is to give our people the voice, you know, help shed some light on what we're doing, enlighten our people, and give some hope to our people that are stuck in the hood that have nothing to do, nothing to look up to, nothing to, you know, nothing. Because I remember being in a situation like, man, I'm tired of being here. What am I going to do? What the fuck am I going to do? And it's hard to think like, yeah, I work hard and do this and get it. But work hard on what? What am I going to do? Some people really don't have no other outlet.
Ain't nothing wrong with being positive, man.
Yeah, no, ain't nothing wrong with being positive, man. Ain't nothing wrong with wanting to have things.
Some motherfuckers don't want to be but
I think they do, but they don't know how to. They're scared. To me, this is my opinion. Some people, and this is my experience with certain people that I've met. There's certain people that want better, but they're scared to do things. They're scared to look soft, so they put on this. Now, fuck that. I'm still here holding it down. I'm going to do this and do that. And that's to make them feel better for being where they're at. But who the fuck, as a normal person, as a man, doesn't want to have things to provide for your kids? Have a better situation for you and your family. Drive something nicer. Eat better food. Whatever it is.
Yeah.
Who the fuck doesn't want that? You really happy fucking having lint in your pockets and sleeping around roaches and shit? And yeah. That, you know, and I'm not taking away no one from in that situation, but I know somebody in that situation doesn't want to be there.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So there's some people that are gonna.
What it say though? I seen like something that said one time, it was like real street motherfuckers is trying to get out the streets for motherfuckers is, you know what I mean, trying to stay in them.
Yeah, like, I said that on one of my songs. Yeah. I'm trying to fight my way out where they're trying to fit in. You know, yeah. These dudes want this. They want to put on an image. They take a picture of hella guns and all this money. They want to show that I'm this dude. Like, this, we use this shit for protection. Yeah, we get dope, but we trying to make it out. You know, there's certain things that we do that.
I don't knock it though, just because we was there. You know what I mean? Like, nah. Me, I was like, I wasn't thinking right at one time either. You know what I'm saying?
See, there's a difference at one time. You were young. Yeah. And I ain't knocking it too, because there's people that are going to get offended by that. But I'm just saying, there's people that do that and they're knocking what we do. So that's fine. If you want to sit there and knock somebody, and I'm not saying we, I'm saying we as anybody that wants to do something with themselves.
Yeah.
So if you got a homie that has goals, and you're like, dude, you're going to talk down on this dude because he's making you feel insecure. I don't give a fuck. I don't care about those type of people, bro, because yeah. I've had those people in my life that try to make me feel guilty for trying to do something myself. Like, I'm out here every day, homie, and you're over there in the studio when you're over here doing this. And I just remember telling the homie, man, that's your bad. That's your bad. You still right there doing the same thing. You know what I mean? Like, if you show me respect and you're like, bro, like you're supposed to, do your thing, homie. Better yourself. Do this, man. That's good. Come on, let's get this. But if you're going to sit there and try to make me feel some kind of like I'm some kind of weak link because I'm trying to do that, then I have no respect for those type of dudes. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
So, like, I ain't knocking no one, but it's like you can't knock me either, you know?
I feel it. Yeah, we should have a blunt spark that should be getting high.
How'd that shit smoke? How'd them run smoke, bro?
That shit was
fire.
Look at him.
Look at that. What about the Mac? You got the Mac yet? You fired that Mac?
Better not have, motherfuckers.
Man. Well, anyways, man, episode number one. It was a pleasure having you on the show,
yeah,
bro.
Likewise, man. Appreciate it, man. You already know it's all love, man.
Man, for real,
been
for real.
Sav it out. So for real shit.
Straight up. Out, so man. For real and Sav it out. You know we go back, good together, man.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know.
We need a feature pretty soon, too.
Yeah, man. Let me know when you need that feature, bro. You know, I got you, man.
Like I said, though, Magic, thank you for having me.
Yeah,
appreciate it. It's always a pleasure, man. You got to
salute,
take
another Salute, man. Salute. Thanks to everybody for tuning in to the first episode of the Big Tone Show. A special thanks to my bro, Deezus Nettles, for pulling up, man, and shedding some light.
It's all love, man.
Spilling some game on everybody. And if you like this video, man, and you want to see more, hit the like, subscribe button, man. Leave a comment below. Let me know your thoughts on the show, man. You know, it's our first show. We're trying to work out the kinks, and we're going to evolve and get better. But I appreciate everybody tuning in. Follow my bro, Deezus Nettles, on Instagram. What's the gram again?
It's at DCSnettles916. Check me out, though.
And everybody have a good day. Safe quarantine, man.
Yeah.
Keep your ass in the motherfucking house. Keep your ass away. Wash your hands and your ass.
And your ass.
stay away from everybody, man, and help squash this bullshit so we could get back to our normal daily routines, man.
Hell yeah.
Everybody have a safe day. Salute. Much love. Salute.
Yeah.